Walden Pond Press and Harper Audio present Harriet Spies by Elana K. Arnold, performed by Taylor Meskimen. For Henry, also known as Professor Higglebottom, Sissy's adores you, you wonderful kid. 1. A Visitor to Marble Island. If you're not a people person, you probably wouldn't like living at a bed and breakfast. Even if you really like beds and you really like breakfasts. Lucky for me, I am a people person, most of the time. I think people are interesting. They look all different sorts of ways, and they do their hair in all different sorts of styles, and they wear all different sorts of outfits. Especially when they are on vacation, and pretty much everyone who comes to my Nanu's bric-a-brac B&B on Marble Island is on vacation. I'm not here on vacation, though. I'm here because my mom back home is pregnant and on bed rest, so she can't look after me, and my dad has to travel for work, so he can't look after me either. Usually, Nanu's job is to run the B&B, but this summer, her job is also to look after me. And my job is to help her with B&B stuff, and also to look after Matzo Ball, the world's best cat. I guess Nanu's basset hound, Moneypenny, doesn't have a job, unless it's hogging the sunny spot in the front window. She's getting a little better at sharing with Matzo Ball, though. Actually, I have lots of jobs. Besides helping Nanu with the B&B and taking care of Matzo Ball, I'm also cleaning out Nanu's storage shed, and I'm making gingerbread birdhouses with Mabel Marble, the neighbor who lives on the other side of the wall in the backyard. And sometimes I help Hans and Gretchen by tasting new ice cream flavors at their shop, though vanilla is still my favorite. My goal was to get the back shed all cleaned out before my dad came to visit me, but it had already been 2 weeks since he'd first brought me to the island, and he was arriving today, and with all my other jobs, the shed still hadn't been cleaned out. Maybe that was better, though. It meant that Dad would be able to help me. Dad likes to be helpful. After we washed the breakfast dishes, Nanu and I got ready to go pick up Dad from the ferry. I was so excited to see him that I kept doing my happy-to-see-Dad dance, which I was making up as I went along. Basically, it involved lots of spins and dramatic arm movements and things like that.
"If you keep that up," said the captain, "poor Moneypenny won't ever settle in for her morning nap."
The captain, a visiting ornithologist to Marble Island, was Nanu's longest-standing guest at the bric-a-brac. An ornithologist, if you don't know, is a bird expert. And do you know what experts love more than almost anything else? Talking about the thing they're an expert on. Don't get the captain going about island loggerhead shrikes if you don't have at least half an hour to listen. In addition to being Nanu's longest-standing guest, the captain is also the tallest, and maybe the strongest. Everything about the captain is impressive. Now she was standing at the bottom of the stairs. She had on her birding vest with all the little pockets and her birding hat with its wide brim, and she wore her binoculars around her neck. She was patting all the pockets of her vest, like she was looking for something. "Moneypenny already had 2 naps this morning," I said, which wasn't technically true, but might have been. "She's all napped out." "Hmm," said the captain, and she looked like maybe she was going to say something else. But just then, Nanu came out of the kitchen carrying a big paper bag, the kind you get from the grocery store, and held it out.
"Here you go, Captain," Nanu said. There was just enough olally berry jam left to make your sandwiches. And there's hard-boiled eggs in a thermos of tea, and fruit, of course. Thank you, Agnes, said the captain. Then she asked, Have you seen my compass?
The captain was one of the smartest people I'd ever met, but she sure did misplace things a lot. Fortunately, Nanu was great at finding things. You know that saying about how someone might lose their head if it wasn't screwed on? I don't think the captain would ever forget her head, but she forgets most everything else, except her binoculars. A bird watcher wouldn't get far without those.
I found the compass on the dining room table and slipped it into your lunch bag so you wouldn't forget it, Nanu said.
Ah, the captain said. Thank you. She took the lunch bag. It looked heavy. Nanu picked up her bright yellow hat from the entry table and pushed it firmly over her curly hair. I like Nanu's hair. I hope that one day when I'm really old, mine will be silver and gray and white and brown like hers.
Agnes, said the captain, frowning, your hat has so much cat hair on it that it's practically meowing.
She set her lunch bag on the front table, took the hat from Nanu's head, and opening the front door, shook it until Matzo Ball's peachy perfect fuzz rose from it in a cloud.
The fusillade of fur is really becoming a problem, she continued. It gets everywhere. Something needs to change.
She handed the hat back to Nanu. He barely drops any fur at all, I said, ignoring the captain's showy big words. Matzo Ball must have heard us talking about him, or maybe he just heard the front door opening. Either way, he appeared like a bolt of silent orange lightning and darted outside. He stopped still, all his perfect whiskers pointing forward. Something was rustling around in the front bushes, and Matzo Ball was going to do his best to sneak up on it. He took one silent step forward, then another. The captain's big square hands reached down and grabbed him just before he leaped into the bushes.
Oh, no you don't, she said.
Meow,
said Matzo Ball, insulted. He wasn't going to hurt anything, I said. He was just exploring.
Tell that to the bird I pried out of his jaws the day before yesterday, said the captain.
She carried Matzo Ball back inside and dropped him unceremoniously on the rug. I could tell from the way he twitched his ears that he was irritated, but he stretched out a leg and began to groom it, pretending that he didn't care at all about the captain.
Harriet, she said, I've told you at least half a dozen times that you must keep a better watch on this feline of yours.
I know that feline is just a fancy word for cat, but it was the way the captain said it that I didn't like. I dropped to my knees and scratched the top of Matzo Ball's head to distract him from the insult. I always know exactly where Matzo Ball is, I said, which was a lie. It's basically impossible to always know where a cat is. They are very particular about their private time. But the captain wasn't listening to me.
Agnes, she said to Nanu, I really do wonder if the cat should be allowed downstairs at all. Between the bird chasing and the shedding and the clawing, it might be better for everyone if he was kept strictly upstairs.
It wouldn't be better for Matzo Ball. I scooped him onto my lap and squeezed his fuzzy, perfect, peachy body. He began to purr. It wouldn't be better for me. I turned to Nanu. Tell the captain that Matzo Ball can go anywhere he wants. But Nanu didn't. Instead, she said,
The captain has a point, Harriet. You do need to keep a better eye on him, cute as Matzo Ball is. His time here hasn't entirely been smooth sailing. If it's too much responsibility for Harriet to mind her cat, the captain said, Maybe Walter could take him back across to the mainland.
There was no way I was going to let Dad take my cat away from Marble Island. And what made the captain think she was in charge anyway? She was just a guest at the bed and breakfast. A bossy guest.
One way or the other, said the captain, picking up her lunch bag. Something must be done about that cat.
I narrowed my eyes at the captain's lunch bag. Then I said, Nanu, did you give the captain all the olive berry jam? I was saving it for Dad.
We can stop by the market for a fresh jar.
Nanu put her hat back on. I didn't really want to make jam sandwiches for lunch. I was just mad at the captain. Sometimes when I'm mad or anxious or bored, I say things that aren't true. It's a bad habit, and one I'm trying to break. But now I had another problem, which was that I didn't want to stop at the market. Let's just make egg salad, I said. I don't want to waste any of my dad time at the grocery store. Dad had told me on the phone that he'd only be able to stay for 4 hours, the time between when the first morning ferry arrived and when the early afternoon ferry left, so that he could get home to Mom before dinner. The captain had given me an old watch with a flashlight and a countdown timer on it, and I had it strapped to my wrist, ready to go. All of us went out of the B&B together after I said goodbye to the pets. Moneypenny was asleep on the window seat, and Matzoball was continuing his tongue bath. He was surrounded by a ring of shedding fur, but I ignored it. Nanu put a sign on the door, back in a jiffy, and the captain walked up the street to her jeep. I wasn't at all sorry to see her go. Then Nanu and I climbed into her golf cart. Almost everyone who lives on Marble Island drives a golf cart instead of a regular car. The captain has a jeep because her job is to study the island loggerhead shrikes, a very important and very specific type of bird. And to do that, she has to drive on the bumpy dirt roads to the middle of the island to observe them. I had been asking her to take me along, but the captain says I have to practice being quiet for 30 whole minutes, all in a row, before she will. Otherwise, I'll scare off the shrikes. That's what she'd originally given me the watch with the timer for. Practice. So far, the best I'd done was 18 minutes and 23 seconds. Nanu started up the golf cart and off we went. I was so excited to see Dad, I could hardly stand it. But luckily, Marble Island is pretty small, and it only took us a few minutes to get to the dock. The ferry was already there. It's early today, Nanu said approvingly. Nanu likes it when things are on time, and she likes it even better when they're early. I jumped out of the golf cart as soon as it pulled up to the curb. A whole herd of tourists was pouring down the ramp from the ferry, a big mess of strollers and backpacks and hats and parasols and people, some pointing at a pelican who sat on the railing, some staring down at their phones as if whatever they were looking at was more interesting than Marble Island, even though they'd just arrived. But no Dad. Maybe he missed the ferry, I said to Nanu, who had gotten out of the golf cart and stood beside me. Or maybe, I said, suddenly sick to my stomach, something is wrong with Mom, and he couldn't come at all. Or maybe, said Nanu, bending down so our cheeks were side by side, he's right there. She pointed, and I looked, and there he was. Blue baseball cap and a big smile. My dad. I ran through the herd of tourists, straight for him. Dad opened his arms and I jumped up and he caught me. Hey there, Harriet. His voice was sort of rough like his cheek. He squeezed me tight for a long time before he set me down, and then he put his big warm hand on my shoulder, right where it belongs. Hello, Walter, said Nanu. Dad hugged her too, and then the three of us made our way back to the golf cart. Right then, if the captain had seen me, she would have been surprised. For once, I couldn't have said a word, even if I'd wanted to. Even though I was happy, my throat felt all tight and full, as if a bunch of words were crowding together and blocking the way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.